bigger represents. What if I told you that this is more related to the butterfly effect than what you think? This theory is chaos, but I will explain it in a while. So let's talk about two important things for climate prediction: the chaos and predictability. So the first question here is to, we have to make ourselves is, how do we make the predictions? That's a tough question, because it's not the same predicting the temperature of tomorrow of Girona than predicting it next season will be slightly warmer or colder than last year.
So the fact is that the time scale matters. And for example, to make a weather forecast, it is important to know the current meteorological state, what for the forecasters like me means initial conditions or predictability of first kind. So at forecast lead times of 1 or 2 days, it is enough to focus just on the faster components of the climate, like for example the atmosphere. So those components that change very fast. And because the slower components of the climate, like for example the ocean, change very little during the lifetime of a weather prediction. And in most of the cases, they are considered as a fixed number. On the totally other side of the time scale bar, we have the climate projections. Climate change projections can be seen as a good example of second kind predictability. It is a boundary condition prediction problem where one climatologist tries to understand how the statistics of the climate change between two different sets of initial of boundary conditions. Let me explain this. It means basically what happens or what would happen in the future climate if we change the balance of energy that enters in the Earth system. And these boundary conditions are typically represented by greenhouse gases, the solar activity, and the aerosol emissions from the volcanic eruptions. And between the weather forecast and the climate projections, we have what we call the seasonal to decadal predictions, which are basically a mixture of initial and boundary condition problems. So this figure here is a schematic representation of the role of three components of the climate system as sources of predictability, which means as sources of information for predicting the future climate. So at short lead times, knowing the initial state of the atmosphere counts the most. But however, if we want to make a prediction for 1 month or beyond that, it is essential to know the ocean state. I will put you an example. Think about when you take a bath in winter. You fill in the bathtub with hot water. Normally, the temperature of the air will be slightly colder. So the temperature of the air will start increasing its temperature. But imagine that now you open the window of the bathroom and the cold air will enter, will come in. So the temperature of the air in the bathroom will change. So cold. But what happens with the water inside the bathtub? It is still warm and its temperature will decrease in a slower speed. This process, but with a higher degree of complexity and in a higher scale, it what happens in the planet Earth. Can the flap of a butterfly in Brazil set off a tornado in Texas? I'm sure Edward Lorenz didn't think about that before 1961, when he was in his laboratory running a numerical model to repeat a weather forecast from the middle of a previous simulation. And he started to notice that the results that he was obtaining were slightly different in the beginning, and then they were drifting more. And while he thought, maybe there is some pipe from the computer or some cable that it's broken and it's causing these errors. But then he came to the conclusion that the initial mistakes that he had introduced as initial conditions for the second time that he wanted to run the prediction. So more exactly, he was introducing just 3 of the 6 original decimals in the initial conditions. So this graph that you see here is its original graph for comparing both simulations. And this figure on the left is the famous Lorentz attractor. So be careful when you make a prediction, because the initial state that you decide might set your future trajectory, and it might be totally different from the one with the other initial conditions. And I cannot finish my presentation without applying the theory of chaos to my own topic of research, which is the Arctic sea ice prediction. So what I did was trying to predict the sea ice area from the Arctic Ocean from 10 different initial states, from 10 different sea ice conditions. And well, basically this is what happens. We see that we start very close, and after some weeks, the sea ice area that we predict starts to diverge. And this is because of the chaos. So we could say that initial conditions are like the ingredients of a cake. We try to have the exact amount of each ingredient, but the cake is always slightly different. So the more cakes you make, the closer you will be to the perfect cake. So bake as many cakes as you can and bring them to Earth Science. Thank you.